This is a daily scene in Caracas. Deadly protests in the capital of Venezuela. Hundreds of thousands of people have taken to the streets. Food and medicine are scarce. Children in school are fainting from hunger. Patients are dying in hospital for lack of basic supplies. Venezuelans queue for hours to buy goods. The currency, the bolivar, is carried in sacks, not wallets. The economy is in freefall. Yet, once upon a time,
Caracas, the swinging city of Venezuela. Good climate, fine buildings, wide highways with plenty on them. All in all, a pretty nice place to be for many reasons.
In 1970, Venezuela was the richest country in Latin America, and average income was higher than its former colonial master, Spain. Venezuela was also held up as a beacon of democracy and stability, an example of a successful developing economy based on oil wealth. So, what went wrong? I'm Linda Yu with The Inquiry on the BBC World Service. Our question this week, how did Venezuela go from so rich to so poor?
Part 1. The Purge.
I'm Venezuelan, so I always was interested on oil issues. I did an internship in the National Oil Company, and from there, you know, I've been studying oil issues most of my life.
Our first expert witness is Francisco Monaldi, an energy policy specialist at Rice University in Texas, who's also been chief oil advisor to Venezuela's main opposition leader.
Venezuela's oil reserves are huge, the largest reservoir of extra heavy oil in the planet, but we can only recover a tiny fraction of those resources as the technology today only allows for that.
Nevertheless, oil accounts for nearly all exports. Oil wealth transformed Venezuela from a poor nation into one of the richest in the world by the 1970s. But that decade also marked the beginning of years of oil price volatility that lasted until this century, when oil surged to record highs. Prices then plummeted in the last few years.
The decline in the price of oil made the problems that the Venezuelan economy had much worse, but the problem started much earlier.
Francisco Monaldi says to understand Venezuela's current crisis, you have to go back nearly two decades. That's when the charismatic left-wing radical Hugo Chavez was swept into power on a wave of populism. In 2002, a few years into his administration, President Chavez decided it was time to purge the national oil company, Petróleos de Venezuela, or PDVSA.
He perceived the national company as an enclave of technocrats that were making it hard for him to implement the reforms that he wanted to do in the country. He believed they were hiding resources from the government.
Whilst managers at PDVSA wanted to focus on increasing production and to work with foreign multinationals, President Chavez saw the company at the heart of his political revolution. He thought PDVSA should help fulfill his popular mandate by funding his social programs and to ultimately even take part in some of them, like distributing food. The resistance of the oil executives happened at the same time as an even bigger threat to President Chavez's authority.
You have to remember that there was an attempted coup against Hugo Chavez at the time. All these events led to this massive conflict inside the company and the oil strike that led to the firing of the executives.
First, President Chavez got rid of the bosses who opposed his plans, and he wasn't discreet about it.
Anuncio la destitución, despido de las siguientes personas.
The president took to national television and named the people he was sacking, dismissing them as if they were footballers who'd broken the rules.
Muchas gracias por su servicio, señor Juan Fernández. está despedido de Petróleos de Venezuela.
Here he is with his whistle.
Cúpula, offside. Offside. No, están comprometidos con el país.
It was a very dramatic episode, and it led to a massive loss of human capital in the national oil company.
When workers at PDVSA went on strike to protest the loss of experienced executives, the 2002-2003 oil strike crippled the economy. In response, President Chavez fired nearly half of the workforce.
That dramatically, of course, diminished the expertise in the national oil company. The government, because the price of oil was high, started a significant program of training of young executives, but it will be very hard to match the expertise accumulated over years of those 18,000 employees. You can see how the loss of expertise is really affecting the company even today.
Francisco Monaldi tells of rusting bolts that should have been replaced years ago, slack safety procedures, and deadly accidents. Years of poor management have taken a toll on PDVSA's output, and matters were made worse by a lack of investment. The National Oil Company couldn't make the most of the country's most abundant resource. So, according to our first expert witness, a loss of expertise in Venezuela's national oil company meant it wasn't operating at its full potential. That hurt the economy even before global prices fell. Nonetheless, hundreds of millions of barrels of oil were still being sold. What happened to the proceeds?
Part 2. Follow the money.
My name is in a list, and frankly, I don't want to go back to my country and find myself lying in a dark alley one day with a knife in my belly.
Our second expert witness, Gustavo Coronel, grew up in Venezuela but fears, after his vocal criticism of the government, he would not be welcome there now. Having served on the board of the National Oil Company in the 1970s, he became an anti-corruption campaigner, setting up his own NGO and working as the Venezuela representative of Transparency International.
Venezuela being an oil country, depending almost exclusively on oil income, made Venezuelans very tolerant of corruption. Venezuelans always felt that there was more where that money came from. Oil, in their eyes, was inexhaustible.
But where did the money go? Gustavo Coronel says a significant portion of those oil revenues went into an opaque fund called Fonden, controlled by the president and just three other people.
Fonden is a financial fund totally parallel to the legal ways money should be handled in Venezuela. In Venezuela, by law, all the money coming from oil income has to be given to the government to do their yearly budget. The National Assembly have to approve the budget. So everybody theoretically should know how the money is spent.
Instead, a lot of it went into a fund with no parliamentary oversight.
Fonden usually received about 25 or even 30% of the total oil income. So you can imagine that the money in the hands of these four men was utilized in consolidating the political power of the government.
Much of the money from Fonden may well have been spent on projects to help less well-off Venezuelans. But for Gustavo Coronel, the secrecy was a big problem.
Of course, when you have no accountability and you have no transparency in how you handle this money, corruption is almost inevitable to take place.
So it wasn't clear how a chunk of the oil money was spent. He also says there was corruption in the way the National Oil Company operated.
Corruption came about because they started giving contracts, large contracts, to companies that were created by relatives and friends of the managers of the company. I believe that corruption is among the main reasons of why Venezuela is in such a miserable situation today. Because, of course, Venezuela has been a petro-state before Chavez came into power, getting almost all their income from oil. There was always some level of corruption, but it was not in the magnitude that we have it today.
Our second expert witness says corruption helps explain why Venezuela had previously prospered from its oil wealth, but no longer does. It's not just oil that operates in a black market today. There's even a black market for money, as the government has lost control of the economy.
Part 3. Out of control.
In my building, after 4 or 5 o'clock in the afternoon, I see people looking at the garbage bags to see what they're getting, and sometimes eating directly from them.
Margarita Lopez Maya lives in Caracas, where food shortages have reached desperate levels. As a professor at Venezuela's Central University, she's in the privileged position of being able to travel abroad for conferences, and that means she can do her grocery shopping.
I had to carry back rice. I carry back bread, believe it or not. I bought these pita bread so that they wouldn't be so big in the luggage. I usually bring my cornmeal, my corn flour in the luggage.
When President Hugo Chavez came into power, she was all for him. He seemed to be solving some of the country's problems.
The first years of Hugo Chavez were full of expectation. He actually did deliver some of his promises. There were more than 30 programs, some of them very successful. The most successful of all of them was the food distribution with subsidized prices. So people had access to all kinds of food, of goods, very, very cheap.
His goal was to help the poor. But some of the policies President Chavez introduced would over time, Margarita Lopez Maya says, prove disastrous. After the coup attempt and oil strike we heard about in part one, President Chavez imposed foreign exchange controls and even capped the prices of basic goods.
Nobody wanted to leave their money in Venezuela. It was so unstable, it was so unpredictable. And so the government felt obliged to control the exchange rate and to put in some regulations to protect the population.
Margarita Lopez Maya says such measures can work as a short-term emergency response, but the government has kept them in place for more than a decade.
There is a tendency to always control everything of the society. So we're talking now more than 14 years with controls.
Venezuela has only recently begun to relax price caps. The government is allowing prices to rise in hopes of stimulating production to address food scarcity. It still maintains multiple exchange rates, including one that keeps basic imports affordable. But a black market has emerged. Dollars are scarce, so anyone who can get their hands on the greenback will ask for a hefty amount.
We have three exchange rates. We have the two official ones. One is at 12 bolivares for a group of basic goods and medicines. The other one is around 700 bolivares per dollar, which is for other basic goods. And the black market last week was 4,400.
As its economy has deteriorated, Venezuela has devalued its currency numerous times. Since the country imports nearly all of its food and goods, a weaker currency means higher inflation, which exceeded 500% last year. Margarita Lopez Maya says the staggering price rises are in part due to these regulations.
Exchange rate controls have been crazy, and regulations on prices has exaggerated the inflation.
In her view, the government's response to the crisis, such as raising the minimum wage to increase people's purchasing power, has actually made things worse.
Part of the inflation is that they print money. Now they pay basically all these rises in the minimum wage. Those are all with printed money.
She says the government's tendency to intervene more and more has also discouraged investment, which is another factor contributing to the economic crisis.
It's the legal insecurity to produce in Venezuela, because the government says one thing today and then the next day he can confiscate your company.
Why would anyone risk investing in Venezuela with such uncertainty? As you've probably realized by now, Margarita Lopez Maya is a Chavista no more. For her, the government's policies over the past decade have played a big part in Venezuela's current economic crisis. We've also heard about an increase in corruption under President Chavez and his protege and successor, Nicolas Maduro, and the running down of the state oil company in the same period. So, is Venezuela's decline all down to Chavez and his followers? Not for those who take the long view.
Part 4. The Devil's Excrement.
I have this wonderful quote from a worker who was fired, and he wrote on his suitcase, leaving the oil camp, returning to Venezuela, as if it was simply a foreign enclave that existed within the heart of Venezuela, but never really was a part of it.
Our final expert witness is historian Miguel Tinker Salas, the son of oil workers. He grew up in one of Venezuela's oil camps.
It was the old company town in which you had a school, you had housing, you had education, and it became a social laboratory for the oil companies, modeling what Venezuela could be.
He recalls growing up in Venezuela during its 1970s golden era when
you had access to the Concorde, you had access to Miami on weekends. Many in the middle class were buying property abroad, were traveling. It was a very sophisticated middle class.
In his view, Venezuela presented a veneer of prosperity, but in reality, it was only for the few.
There were two Venezuelas, one that benefited directly from oil profits and one that lived in the shadows of oil, but never really saw fully the benefits from the oil economy.
Those largely hidden, long-standing problems are now visible. Miguel Tinker Salas says the seeds of the current crisis were sown a century ago. After Venezuela's oil industry took off in the 1920s, the country's dependence on one commodity was quickly apparent.
Venezuela, since 1935, was actually a net importer of food, so that you already had the economic structures in Venezuela already being deformed by the dependence on oil production.
A reliance on oil meant importing, instead of producing, food and other goods. Venezuela's government had considered diversifying the economy.
In the early 1940s, as the country was transitioning from a set of military governments to democracy, many people proposed to use oil profits to produce an alternative form of development, to actually focus on agriculture.
But he says such economic models for Venezuela were rejected because politicians portrayed oil as synonymous with development.
Oil and modernity, oil and progress, oil and democracy.
He says that set Venezuela on a disastrous path.
In many ways, the country turns its back on its own history, on its own previous agricultural development, on its own coffee production, cacao production, and other agricultural products that it had during the early part of the 20th century, and begins increasingly wholly to rely upon oil.
Miguel Tinker Salas doesn't let the politicians who've led the country off the hook. Although he does give some credence to President Maduro's claim that Venezuela is the victim of a Washington plot.
I think there's no doubt that Venezuela has been signaled for regime change, first by the Bush administration, then by the Obama administration. But I don't think that the current crisis can only be put at the footsteps of the North American government or any other government.
Sharing the oil riches with the poor through housing, food, and health programs improved the quality of life in Venezuela and reduced inequality. But Miguel Tinker Sala says it was unsustainable.
Those were possible as long as oil profits remained high. But as soon as they began to decline, that became impossible to maintain, and that put a further strain on the economy.
Why has every government fallen into the same trap of oil reliance?
Because it's the easiest thing to do. I mean, when you have a dependence on oil, to try to sell to the population that you're now going to diversify the economy, that they cannot have the expectations of life that they are used to, and that they're going to have to sacrifice, no politician will do that.
The curse of oil was recognized by a Venezuelan oil minister as early as 1976.
He described oil as the excrement of the devil because he talked about the near total dependence. We have oil, but we import everything else.
So, how did Venezuela go from so rich to so poor?
If I had to summarize it, it lies in oil.
All our expert witnesses agree that generation after generation of politicians have failed to learn the lessons about how to use Venezuela's oil wealth. It can be used to diversify the economy into new industries. It can be saved in a fund to help soften the ups and downs of the market. But successive Venezuelan governments have instead deepened the country's reliance on oil. The challenge with long-standing problems is it can take a while to recognize the economic and political damage. Gustavo Coronel likens Venezuela to a simmering pot.
If you put a frog in a pail of hot water, the frog will jump out. But if you put this frog in a pail of lukewarm water and then start slowly increasing the temperature, this frog is going to boil without knowing what happened to her. And this is exactly what happened to us in Venezuela.
This edition of The Inquiry was presented by me, Linda Yu, and produced in London by Simon Mabin and Phoebe King. It was mixed by Graham Potterfoot and edited by Hugh Levinson. You can find all our episodes by subscribing to our podcast. Search for BBC Inquiry Podcast. And if you like The Inquiry, you might also enjoy Crowd Science, also from the BBC World Service, crowdsourcing the answers to your science questions.